Welcome. I realize I've been putting a lot of video up there for people to watch, and they can't get to all of it necessarily. But it's justified because the milestones that have been reached and passed right now are truly epic, actually. And I'm just like in a state of just, wow, this is good news. This is really good news. And this morning I reached some milestones that are pivotal, so pivotal. I'm just so happy to have reached these milestones. All in line with the progress that has come before, all in line with the continuity fear. Everything, the track, you know, is bringing me to where I need to be. Now, can it be explained? I don't know. It's so dependent on sort of a holistic clarity. The clearer you get, the more holistic your clarity becomes, and therefore you're able to get shifts of perspective where you suddenly see the whole situation in a much clearer light. And it's sort of difficult to break it all down into pieces in order to put into words, right? I spoke several videos ago about how our blocks are the blocks that we have are actually actors and actresses we're hiring to scare us off acceptance of our true nature. Our attitudes come from us. They don't come from outside of us. And we're hiring them to intimidate us and bully us away. And I said how you can forgive yourself and accept them, thank them for their great acting job, and then tell them, okay, I have a new acting job for you. And give them a new acting job, which is to welcome you, to roll out the red carpet, to welcome you home. Well, last night I was feted by someone playing guitar, I think, or so, and singing this song to me. And the song was Jesus Saves Today. And I joined into the last verse singing it. And so some attitude in me that instead of, like, who are you? What are you doing here? You don't belong here. I mean, get out of here. Instead, now they're singing a song and welcoming me. It happened one day, the turnaround that fast. So, it wouldn't surprise me. I would not be surprised or resist that the red carpet is starting to be, you know, rolled out for me now because I've recognized that this dynamic and have said, okay, time to change your attitudes towards me, towards spirit. Now, even more importantly, a milestone is I became aware of, in dialogue with resistance, this insistence that nobody can help me, nobody can help me, nobody can help me, no one can help me. This is what pulled me into this world in the first place. I became aware of this again. I was in dialogue with this resistance, like as if I was talking with some person, and how they kept demanding that I do this and this and this and this. And I said, no, 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 no. And finally, they suddenly lapsed into this mantra of nobody can help me, nobody can help me, you know, screaming and tears and so on. And I realized that what they're really insisting that we help them on is we help them establish, to permanently and endlessly establish these imaginary laws that they think exist as real. Time, space, process, and form. And they say, nobody can help me do this. Nobody can help me do this. It's true. And so what I did was I agreed with them. I said, that's right. I can't help you do that. And that changed everything. Then I became aware that I don't need to even appear as though I can help them with that. And it's perfectly okay for me to agree and say, yes, exactly right. I cannot help you with that. Nobody can. You're exactly right. Agree with them when they say, nobody can help me. Nobody can help. Before I said, oh, isn't that awful? Let me try to help them. Now I'm agreeing, say, you're exactly right. Nobody can help you. Nobody can help you accomplish the impossible. That is exactly right. And I'm not going to even pretend to be able to help you with that. And then I realized, wow, I don't need to be the way that I've been previously in this life, which is actually pretending to be able to help them. So I could kind of talk to them and reassure them. One moment. Okay. So I realized that the way that I've been in my life is I've been trying to appeal to these people who say, nobody can help me, nobody can help me, to try to say, well, I'm going to try to help you. I'm going to try to help you because I felt so sorry for them, so terrible. And so I actually, the way I've been is to appeal to these people who claim nobody can help them. And now I realize, no, I'm agreeing with them. You're right, nobody can help you with what you're asking for. Nobody can help you with what you're asking for. That's right. And so I no longer need to appeal to those people who are just insisting that help has to be in the form of helping them accomplish the impossible. And then I realized, wow, I don't have to be the way that I am, have been, which is so much suffering, deprivation. And I realized what they really want is somebody who is just destitute and still able to say, you know what, maybe this will help you. What they really want is a picture of absolute destitution to convince them that these laws exist. And I've been that way for most of my life, feeling just horrible, thinking that this will help them somehow. But now I see I don't have to do that. And I can have abundance. I can have overflowing abundance of positivity. And of course they'll keep screaming, gee, you can't help me. I say, you're right, I can't. That's right. I can't help you accomplish the impossible. However, I can help you evaporate the continuity fear. I can encourage you to evaporate the continuity fear and motivate you to do that. You see? So that's a pivotal experience where you realize that the persona, the way you've been appearing, you don't have to continue to appear that way, and understanding why you have appeared that way in the past. And now you know you don't have to. You don't have to anymore. And you can appear in a positive light, very positive light. So I instructed the whole inner, just fly running and fly here, whole apparatus, the entire being, to say, support this now, support the overflowing positivity and abundance. Be supportive of that. And so get that momentum going like that. So we are we're in a very good situation. Now, this is such a huge breakthrough that I'm just kind of staying present with it. I feel fine. There's no upheaval or anything taking place, but it looks promising. It looks very promising that I was able to get to what is it that tricked me in the first place. I have to keep brushing this fly. What is it that tricked me in the first place? And how is it that I cannot be fooled again by this? Is it possible to not get pulled, continue to be tricked by it? And if I'm not tricked by it, then what are the benefits of that, you see? And then allowing the benefits to arrive. Now, in the previous video, how to manage the death of Mother Nature successfully, where you realize there's no such thing as time, space, process, or form whatsoever. These are imaginary laws that we're inferring. Our creativity is making it possible to infer that these exist. And of course, what we're asking is try to make these laws real. We think that they exist, but they're not endless. So what we're trying to do is make them endless, eternal. Right now we think they're temporary laws, but we're trying to find a way. So that's why we say, nobody can help me make these, you know, eternal. How do I make this life here in this world eternal life? cannot. So he said, nobody can help with that. For instance, Jesus is just somebody who knows that he cannot help with that. Positive, totally clear, he cannot help with that. Nobody can. It's funny that enlightenment is more about what you cannot do, accepting what you can't do. All right? It's accepting what we cannot do. That is what brings the overflowing abundance. It's important to note that I do suggest at this point that this is the proper way to go about this whole issue of abundance. Not trying to pray for it directly, you know, as this is a very big thing, especially among younger generation, it seems, of getting all the stuff they want. And there's a way to use spiritual power to get this and stuff. I don't see that as being the right way to go about it. I see it as just a byproduct of realizing what you cannot do and accepting that what you cannot do, then the Holy Spirit is the one that will simply bring you whatever you need. You don't need to pray directly for any sort of abundance or any sort of health or anything at all. See, I've really never done that, never been into that. You have to get to the root of the situation, and then essentially you realize I am. The I am-ness. Just I am, right now. You know. The I am-ness. I am just the I am-ness. No forces, time, space, process, form. No process at all, just I am. And it's starting to realize, yeah, the I am-ness. Oh, that is. Now, I've never got that before. I never understood what do they talk about? I am-ness. And it's starting to feel it, like, ah, okay. It's very advanced, actually, to get that. So the way to do it is to realize what you can't do. You cannot help anyone here at all to establish laws that don't exist and make them eternal. There's nothing you can do to help them. And that, as far as that goal is concerned, there's absolutely nothing anyone could do to help them with that. Nothing whatsoever. By accepting that and owning that, that is the key. That is the key, actually. Then you don't have to appear as if somehow you're capable of helping them. And certainly when they see like a great saint or whatever, they don't feel that they're capable of helping them. They say, ah, they don't understand my situation. They have this overflowing abundance. That's not going to get the job done. They don't understand how deprived I feel, you know. And of course, because they can't help you with that. They're not here to help you with that. They're not here to help you with accomplishing the impossible. They're here to help you relinquish that goal. And in relinquishing that goal, you've experienced the I am-ness. The am-ness. And you experience the overwhelming, overflowing abundance that is. Okay. That is not bound to any of these imaginary laws. You become miraculous. I mean, your presence is miraculous. And of course, those who are trying to establish these laws as permanent are saying, oh, this isn't helping us at all. In fact, this is the opposite of what we want. So when we simply accept the I am-ness, we can turn our lives, our temporal, our appearance lives, at least in other people's perspective, over to the Holy Spirit and say, it's all yours now. You live that life. I'm simply abiding in the I am-ness. This is what they say, Jesus died for your sins. This is what they meant. He died so you could live. Meaning, let the principle of grace, God's grace, let that live your quote-unquote life, the life of searching for values. And if it ever finds any value to delusion, it will certainly keep it for you, no question about it, and give it to you, so you will not be impoverished from that. But you now are just dwelling on the I am-ness, free of all sin, meaning believing in forces that don't exist. And the Holy Spirit now is living your temporal life, the life that of supposedly bound by forces, and is engaged in the play with others who also believe in that. That's the Holy Spirit's now is living, not me anymore. I'm simply abiding in the I am-ness. So this is the now understanding the message of Christianity. Christ died for your sins so that you could be saved. Meaning, just what I said is just, you turn over your fake life, the search for value in what doesn't exist, to the Holy Spirit and say, it's yours. This is your life now. I have no more interest in it. But I understand that people want to still get some inner communication from the body. That's fine. But you are no longer searching for any value whatsoever within the mirage of forces that don't exist. You're simply seeing all value in I am. I am-ness being as the only value. So I saw this morning. I said, wow. The central message there of Christianity, another central aspect, it turns out to be true. If you understand it properly and really understand it, Christianity is a very extremely high teaching, actually. And problem is a lot of people, pagans were converted through the various wars that the pagans were fighting, and one pagan fought under the cross and defeated another pagan army, and they said, okay, you'll have to convert into this. But it wasn't the kind of conversion that comes about through a lifetime of effort and clarification, so you really, really see it. See, there has been a lot of that throughout history, but a lot has also been through conquest and rulers deciding that for purposes of administration, etc., this is very useful to keep the population easily dealt with and administrated, etc. Various reasons, but not because they necessarily understood the real message. So let God created the Holy Spirit to take care of time and space, process form, this illusion. So let the Holy Spirit take care of that. That's no longer our business. It's no longer our business. Once we admit we can't help at all with this, we cannot help at all. So it's no longer our business. It's the Holy Spirit's business. So wherever I go, or whatever I say, whatever I do, that's the Holy Spirit's business, not my business at all. My business is just simply be abide and be aware of the I am-ness. In other words, there's no presence whatsoever of any forces, just the I am-ness and the natural, whatever I desire to experience is. There's the undisturbed I am-ness of all. The undisturbed I am-ness of all. And all we need to do is abide that, you see. So this is all becoming, coming up and being clarified now, which is a very hopeful scenario developing here, actually. My generation and generations around me, so the age area around, is in a very unique situation, in that the New World Order people are pushing so hard for their objective now that they've just, we're not really on the radar at all. And we feel like sort of a lost and forsaken generation, without any respect, really, any reason people respect us. Be some way that we could feel like, you know what? We don't, going, deciding we're not going to be part of the New World Order, that's perfectly fine. That's great. We don't need to be. And we can have some respect, you know what? Because the I am, I amness, this whole thing can be worked through. So I hope that my generation, and of course everyone of all generations who also feel they don't need to go along with this, can feel a sense of, hey, you know what? Truth is still with us. God is still with us. We don't have to feel that we have such needs. Now, I want to bring something up. Not too quickly here. Let's see how this settles in. I really don't know what the Holy Spirit will do. But we'll find out, that's for sure. We'll soon find out because these milestones are being passed. Now, some older people, they're figuring, how can we fit into the New World Order? And others are saying, there's nothing for me here. And they're feeling just like, what's the use? Let me just wait till I die here, and kind of feeling very negative. But what I'm saying is the spiritual path is totally 100% more important than the New World Order. And you can take that path, you can relate to that path. If there are others, if there's some in this world who have taken that path and successfully, then you can actually relate to that. And in doing so, you will feel part of something that is infinitely more valuable to you than the New World Order, you see, as well as just succumbing, being crushed by it too. Now, getting your attention onto this is the whole deal, right? What I'm seeing in the world, as far as our attention goes, which is all important, our attention is all important. Where is our attention? What I'm seeing is there is this New World Order developing, which is actually being instigated from the mental level by those who are not from this planet. Okay, who have been dwelling on other places in the cosmos, who view this planet as an ultimate prize because of the biodiversity, the resources, etc. And most planets are terraformed according to very strict technological standards. This planet has developed naturally, so there are those who are working, have been working, who are not from this planet, mentally taking control of this planet at the mental level first, and then that will step down through the emotional, through the physical, and they call this the New World Order. Now, these entities are very tricky, very clever, and they're very experienced at this. So there's one facet of this, to flesh this out entirely, actually. We see those who are leading, you know, to the world, New World Order, and then we also see the resistance to it, right? We see the resistance to it, all these people pounding and saying. What I've seen, what I'm starting to get, I'm saying, wow, this is possible. This is really possible that these entities are so tricky that not only do they cultivate the pro-New World Order people and have them moving, they're also behind the anti-New World Order people and consciously controlling them, so that the world thinks that the opposition, they need to put their attention on the opposition. Say, yeah, well, let's support the opposition. We need our attention there. And yet all these people are railing against it, most of them. They're not offering any remedy whatsoever. And so as you keep putting your attention on the opponents of the New World Order, you are literally, by default, falling right into the New World Order, because you don't have anything better than it, really. You don't have anything better than it, you see. Very tricky on their part. So they support both sides, the pro and the con, making sure that the con is carefully controlled also as to what they say. I've noticed that it's just all anger. We hate. No real remedy whatsoever. This most certainly will lead you destitute in terms of truly opposing it, or truly saying, how do you oppose it? Say, you don't oppose it. You say, I got something way better. I don't need to give my attention to you at all. In fact, I can't help you at all. Hey, New World Order, I can't help you in the slightest bit. That is the remedy. I can't help you. I can't help you. I can't help you accomplish the impossible. Nobody can. So I'm going to then, therefore, abide in I am. And let the Holy Spirit live my life. Live not my life, live this appearance. Let the Holy Spirit take care of this appearance. This apparent appearance. You know? That's way better. So the way to deal with these interlopers is to simply find something that is infinitely better than what they have to offer. But the resistance to the New World Order doesn't provide that in the slightest bit. I've been paying attention to this for a long time, saying, wow, something weird about this resistance. It's all shouting, hey, we don't like this. This isn't right, you know. Power to the people, blah, blah, blah. They're never talking about what is truly better and actually clarifying it and saying, hey, you know, so that's what I've been doing. What I did was I pointed out on YouTube, it's going to be real bad. The doomsayers, all this, they're fundamentally accurate. But I said, listen, the answer is spiritual to this whole thing. You have to clarify what is better. So you'll say, oh, this is what I really want. New World Order, don't need it. You have to get to a point where you say, I don't need this, in a positive way. I don't need this, I have something infinitely better. But thanks for asking. That's it. And that's just not happening. It's happening here for sure. It's happening here for sure. And in some other places, I would suppose for sure, yeah. But by and large, the resistance to the New World Order is actually totally playing into the hands of the New World Order, because those who are leading that resistance and the ones that really, you know, they actually are covert agents of the New World Order. They're actually agreeing with the New World Order. They're actually leading us right into it. By pretending to be champions of opposing it, you see. Yeah, that's how clear the situation is here. Those who truly oppose it are those who simply realize they don't need it. No necessity to it whatsoever, and have a positive, very positive alternative. You see, wow, I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I'm not under the dominion of any forces whatsoever. Forces of duration, location, etc. No, the I am-ness is seamless. Very active fly there. The I am-ness is seamless. There's no break in it whatsoever. And this, you cannot explain it in words. This will dawn upon us. I know I've struggled my whole life with this. What are they talking about? It just doesn't make any sense. It can't really sink in. So when it dawns, just let it dawn. Just let it dawn for you. But we have this New World Order situation, which is definitely taking place here. Worse than anybody knows, really. And we have to be able to positive, in a very positive way, embrace that which is infinitely better. the I amness, the vision of oneness. And agree, yeah, I can't help you. Because, of course, these people are screaming, playing, nobody can help me, nobody can help me. And these interlopers, clever interlopers, come in and exploit that and say, oh, yeah, we can help you. We can help you make these forces eternal. Look how much technology we've developed by believing in these, that these forces are real, you see. And the people of the world say, oh, my God, wow. And they're transfixed by that, hypnotized by it. But when we realize, no, there are no such forces. It's only a testimony to the incredible creativity that we are, that we're able to make it seem as though these forces exist, even temporarily. But we certainly cannot make them eternal, can we? Not even our creativity can convince us that they're eternal, these forces, right? Something within us tells us they're not. Even our creativity cannot overcome this inner knowing, right? This inner knowingness. And we cannot overcome this inner knowingness. So these interlopers prey upon our spiritual situation, is what they do. But if our spiritual situation is improved, then there's nothing for them to prey upon. Nothing for them to prey upon. They will start thinking, wow, there's nothing for us here, really. I could feel like this is unstable, very unstable situation here. And they'll start feeling that way. Because we're saying, there is no here. There's only I am here, everywhere. They don't like that, you know, really. Freaks them out. So agree, yes, I can't help you. Agree with your adversary. Absolutely, I cannot help you. And I'm not trying to pretend that I can. In this, right? Not trying to pretend that I can. But I can't help the evaporation of the continuity fear. If you repent and you have a different goal, then I can help with that. But the goal that you have now, I cannot help in any way. And not even going to pretend that I can. It's very liberating, extremely liberating. So the New World Order situation is just like that little fly that kept buzzing around. Just brush it off like that. Maybe just a little bit annoying, or not even that. Just practically, you just brush it aside. So again, as always, this is very heavy information to realize that the opposition, for the most part, on this planet to the New World Order is actually part of the New World Order. That's very heavy for many of us to realize. I just realized it this morning. I said, oh, wow, yeah, that really fits. And this is a classic maneuver, It's like in warfare, The one side actually like supports, puts in place the generals of the other side and builds them up as big patriotic, you know, we're going to defeat this enemy. But actually they're secretly working for the other side because these generals are incompetent. And what happens is they lead their forces into battle in the wrong way and they get slaughtered and the other side wins. This is actually classic. Textbook here. Some people kind of been aware of this, like, say, you know what? There's something fishy going on here. You see, the way to deal with the New World Order is, again, we don't need it. That's it. Don't need it. No need for it. No interest in it. No attention on it. We just abide in I am-ness. The am-ness. I am-ness. But you can't force that. You just have to keep letting it sink in. It will. Don't need it. So we remain very positive because we're going towards a positive goal. Vision of oneness, pure happiness. Because when you have pure happiness, you're showing that there are no forces other than the law of what I desire to experience is. And those who want to establish these forces as real and permanent and endless, saying, well, that's, you're not helping me. That's not helpful for me. You're not helping me. Pure happiness doesn't help me. Well, that's right. It doesn't. That's exactly right. I mean, therefore, I can't help you. I can't help you reach the goal that you are pursuing, that's for sure. And then they say, well, okay, I'll change my goals, but first you got to... No, no first about it. First you repent. First you have to repent. I say, no, that's not fair. Let's do it at the same time. No, first you repent. I'm going to stay as I am. I'm going to stay in I am. I'm going to stay in I am-ness, no matter what you do. Whether you repent or not, I'm going to stay in I am-ness. Now, when you repent, you will suddenly say, oh my gosh, that's great. Someone's in I am-ness. How wonderful. See? But until you repent, you won't see it that way. You'll think some deal has to be made. Some deal between these forces and the laws of God, the law of God. There are no other forces. How can God make a deal? There are no other forces. The Holy Spirit doesn't make a deal. It just simply pragmatically manages the winding down of belief, okay, in what doesn't exist, to hasten the end of the stream. So it just sort of housekeeping. It's a great housekeeper, and sweeps up all, you know, the whatever delay is dropped. It cleans it up, that kind of thing. It's not agreeing that there's some compromise or some between forces don't exist and not. There's an intermediate step. We understand that. That's different than a compromise. What we're saying is, yeah, these forces don't exist, and I'm accepting this, but I need at least a form to appearance to at least seem to have some stability to it for a little while longer. But I understand this is an illusion, of course. Yes. But it helps me evaporate the rest of my continuity fear. That's not a compromise. Evaporating your continuity fear is not a compromise. It's pragmatic progress. It's a pragmatic step. But it's not any sort of compromise between what doesn't exist and what does. As an agreement, validating what doesn't exist as existing, you see. There's a difference between compromise and working on the continuity fear. And you won't understand it until you repent. You will not understand it. Because you don't want to understand it. Those who don't repent don't want to understand it. They want to believe that the compromise means that these forces do exist. It's just we haven't figured out how to make them endless yet, eternal. That's how they look at it. So they're just saying they want God just to represent a little bit of time, to recognize a little bit of time for them. But in paradise, it's obvious that it's love and the living light that is giving rise to all these appearances. They're just appearances, just being sustained by the desire of love. It is not being sustained by any forces, time, space, process, or form. It is not being sustained by any of that. It, moment by moment, it is being sustained for us, and we're aware of that. So it's not a compromise of recognizing that time is real. It is not like that, no. But all of this falls on deaf ears for the unrepentant, those who have not decided, okay. The only problem I really have is the continuity problem. That's it. I don't have the problem of how do I make these non-existent law forces real. I don't have that problem anymore. I've given up trying to do that. It's only a question is how do I back away from this apparency gradually. The creativity we've used to make it seem that these forces must be there, how do I back away from that gradually enough so the continuity fear doesn't get too severe? That's the only question. How to back away from it. Backing away from it is not compromising. It's a process that you're constantly evaporating, constantly backing away more and more and more. It's not a truce. You're not reaching a truce. You're not reaching a compromise agreement. You are progressively backing away from it. And that progression does have milestones, but those milestones don't represent a truce or a compromise. You're going all the way. And from the very beginning, when you repent, you say, I'm going to take this all the way through. There's no compromise in that position at all. Of course, it may seem to take time, duration, etc., but it's just moment by moment by moment, we feel we have less need, less need, less need, less need, less need of all this very clever creativity that we use to try and convince ourselves that these forces existed. We have less need, our attention doesn't need to be focusing on that the way that we're seeing it, less and less and less and less gradually. And the difference will not be appreciated by the unrepentant. They cannot appreciate it. They cannot. It doesn't serve their purpose to appreciate it. But they always want to think that you can help them in some way. No, you cannot. You cannot help the unrepentant. You cannot be helped. There is no force capable of accomplishing the impossible. God's will is not capable of destroying God's will. Going against God's will, no. No such capability. And the problem is that what we want, it was the continuity fear, we want it to all seem real. And then we say, then we'll back away. That will cure the problem, we think. That will cure the continuity problem. We just make it these forces real, and we won't be so afraid. And this is a backwards, upside down backwards way of going about it. They say, well, that'll save a lot of time. I'll get rid of this fear. No. What they're saying is, if they could make these forces real and eternal, then there would be no reason to have to return back to reality or have to realize these forces don't exist. And so they say there would be no continuity fear. Magical solution that, of course, could never work. So repentance is absolutely necessary. Dealing with this fear, continuity fear, is absolutely necessary. And it's a real pain, of course. It really is. It's the price that we paid for our misadventure, something that will certainly give us pause in the future in terms of doing it again. That's for sure, right? When you realize just how difficult it is to get out of this conundrum, dilemma, certainly going to say, wow, I'm not going to entertain that idea again of being separate from God. That gives rise to a horrible continuity problem. So no one is doing you any favors by promising you that you don't need to struggle with this continuity fear problem. You absolutely do. You have to struggle with it. You have to go through the ordeal of the path. And of course, everybody's trying to avoid that. They want to have their cake and eat it too. They want to pursue trying to be separate from God, you know, to a huge extent, believe that these forces are real, and totally support all of that. At the same time, they don't want to suffer any continuity fear whatsoever. This is unrealistic. You do not suffer any actual separation from God, but you do suffer the continuity fear, without question you do. And of course, we feel we're so clever that we feel there's a way around it. But you keep in mind that we're talking about simply familiarity here. There's no way around, there's no clever way around familiarity. There is none. What you're used to is what you're used to. Period. There's no arguing with that, right? What you're used to is what you're used to. In order to get used to something else, that's a continuity issue, and that takes gradualism. There simply is no, you know, clever way around it. So really, who wants to spend their life struggling with this continuity fear? Don't we want to be happy and living their life happily? Well, unfortunately, this is the burden, as they say in Christianity. You must pick up your cross, if you know you're lost. That cross, carrying that cross, is the continuity fear. It's the burden, realizing you do have this burden. And it starts off by realizing where true happiness really is, and then you realize, wow, I'm not used to that. I'm not accustomed to believing that way. And then you have to change your belief system. You have to exchange belief systems. And no one's doing you any favor by claiming that this is easy, really. It is certainly doable. In fact, has to be done and will be done, but it's going to involve your attention, your time, attention, your effort. You're going to feel uncomfortable. You're going to feel pressure, strain, some fatigue. You're going to feel some fear. You're going to feel like it's an ordeal. And that's carrying the cross. Jesus carrying the cross, you know, it's an ordeal. It's heavy. It's a heavy burden. Knowing that happiness is there for us, and yet realizing that we're so used to this other belief system that, wow, it's just going to, I've just got to be patient, and it's not going to happen just instantly for me. Yeah. It's been tough. But it's not as tough as you think, because you gradually realize that Mother Nature and going around this world and stuff is a waste of time. It's a waste of time. You don't really gain anything from that. So it's better to just hunker down and get this job done that needs to be done. And then, wow, you're liberated into I am-ness. Liberated into the I am-ness. The here-now-ness. The oneness. And from there is just, you know, overflowing glory forevermore. And so it's simply the price we have to pay. The New World Order says, no, don't worry, you don't have to pay that price. We'll fix that for you. We'll have machines that'll do it for you. We'll have chemicals, drugs, genetic engineering. We have all this stuff, and you can just keep on living your life full blast, happy, you know, hedonistic way. Don't worry. We'll solve that problem. Whatever your problems are, we know how to solve them through technology. And people easily say, oh, wow, that's great. Whereas if you've been on the path and you've already evaporated a lot of the continuity fear, you say, you realize, ah, no, not interested in that. I'm almost finished with what really works. So no attraction to that. That's the great thing that of the help we got in this world during this last century, given this opportunity to steal a march on this New World Order takeover, where we're able to evaporate enough of our continuity, concern, and fear, where it no longer appeals to us. We say, I don't need that. The magical thinking that they bring, it doesn't appeal to us, because it's really a way to people who feel that there's all this really tough work they need to do. Someone telling them, don't worry, you don't need to do that. I've got a way around that. And they say, oh, great, thank you. And they go for it easily. But for me, I say, well, I've already done the work, so your offer is meaningless to me. Plus, I realize it's totally bogus. Yeah, if I hadn't have done the work, for sure, I would have. You would think I would have been trapped in that. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, I'd be all for it. I'd say, wow, there must be a better way. There must be a way where we don't really have to deal with this familiarity issue. You know, and then get traps you into another cycle of wasting your time. I'm just wandering about aimlessly, really. Now, what about those who have done some work? Keep working on it, because you will succeed. You will succeed. What's another 10 years of effort, you know, from anyone, compared to a whole other cycle of futility? Maybe long, long, long cycle of just making the continuity fear even more intense for yourself. Running into all sorts of frightful dead ends, feeling aimless and meaningless and all that stuff. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. So the greatest defense against the New World Order and the mental manipulation of this world is your spiritual work ethic, your work ethic. That is the ultimate defense. And if you have that, you will be able, likely, to resist the temptation. Very likely. We talk about work ethics in this world, the Puritan work ethic, and people going out in business and working like crazy, you know, so hard. They have tremendous work ethic in business. But there's also a spiritual work ethic you can have, which I've had, is just working, you know, tremendously every day on spiritual truth. And that's actually the work ethic that you need. That protects you from this mental manipulation, which is offering you what seems to be an easy way out when there isn't an easy way out. The spiritual work ethic is the easy way out, because the other way just doesn't get anything done. It's like you don't want to clean up your room, and you just refuse to do it, and never gets cleaned up. And you just think that's going to happen magically, and you keep going in there, and it's still just as bad as ever. And so at the end of the day, your room is still completely messed up, and you spent all this miserable time hoping that it wouldn't be, and you still have to do the work. So, you know, it's a horrible deceit that they bring, the New World Order is bringing, a horrible deceit. And yet it's very attractive to those who are spiritually lazy. As I recounted several times back in 1978, when I first came across A Course in Miracles, I think it was 78. Yeah. Right, it was 78. I had this dream, and I was in a classroom, and there was this book, and we were studying it, and I left the classroom, and then I heard this voice say, "Why did you leave?" And I remember when I left, I was in this driving rain, just super intense, heavy storm rain. It was just like horrible. I said, "Why did you leave?" And it said, was it too difficult, too difficult?" And I said, "No, it wasn't too difficult." And then it said, then are you lazy? I said, "Is that it? You're too lazy to do it?" And then I said, wow, that hit home. I said, yeah, it was just laziness. I thought, you know, maybe there's a way around it, but it was really just laziness. And then I became super determined, you know, very angry and upset at myself, very determined I'm not going to be lazy. The one thing I'm not going to do is be lazy. And so from that point on, I took it to heart, and I've never been lazy a day in my life. Really wasn't ever up to that point either, but this really meant in the going forward, I was not going to take, you know, be lazy. And that's the saving grace, is anyone who can impart this to you, that being lazy is the worst thing possible on the spiritual path, and you get a feeling like, you know what, I am not going to be lazy. That's the best. That's the very best attitude possible, because it's totally necessary to grind out bit by bit, gradually, every day, evaporate more and more and more, and keep the momentum going, to establish and momentum and keep it going. That's the whole trick, secret to it. That's it. Because if you do that, you're going to succeed for sure. If you don't do that, you're going to fail for sure. So it's just a matter of every day getting up and like going to work. Just, you know, you have to do it. You have to do it. Even if you don't feel like doing it, you have to do it. Just to keep the momentum going. If you feel like, you know what, I just don't feel like this is going to be fruitful. Well, you say, well, okay, but to keep the momentum going, I'm not going to break, you know, I'm going to still try. I'm still going to try. Even if it doesn't be very fruitful, I'm still going to give the effort, I'll give the time, I'm going to give it everything I got. And whatever happens, happens. And you just keep doing that. You just decide, I'm not going to quit on this, I'm going to keep working. Then the interlopers will say, hey, you know, you haven't succeeded. And you can say, well, I got a lot of momentum and I'm going to keep it going because I know I will eventually. And you're, you know, impervious to their enticements, really. Very much impervious to it. Because they're really tempting you to be lazy. They're really tempting you to be lazy. And you say, yeah, it's not that big of a deal to keep the momentum going. I'm gonna keep it going. I can do it. I'm used to it. So those who have helped out with that are extremely helpful, actually. And the teachers, the Holy Spirit, certainly, Jesus, certainly, Sri Sri Ananda Mahima, certainly, who her whole thing was, don't be lazy. And she's very nice to everybody, but also very dynamic in terms of pointing out your laziness and shaming you about it, or, you know, just sort of like, wow, you really think that you're so great, but look at this laziness, look how lazy you are. I mean, do you really want to keep doing that? Is that right? And oh, no, and really put you on the spot. She was not afraid to put people on the spot and say, you know, hey, look at this laziness, wow. You really think you're going to succeed? No way you're going to succeed being that lazy. You say you want to be like me, you embrace the oneness. Well, yeah, but look at your laziness. How are you going to realize that, being so lazy? And so this really permeated the world. Ramana Maharshi too. These spiritual teachers permeate the world with this work ethic, spiritual work ethic. And we pick this up. Those who are sensitive pick it up and they say, hey. Well, everybody's aware of it at some level. We pick it up, but we're willing to look at it and be influenced by it and say, wow, I really got to get after this. Can't be lazy. Cannot be lazy and succeed. It's impossible. And, of course, I don't mean just going through the form of religion. There are people who can attend Mass every day or church service, whatever, and they don't get it at all. They're just saying, I'm lazy, but I'm going to give the appearance of not being lazy. That's not it. You know the difference. Not being lazy means you give it everything you got, and then you say, you know what? I'm getting a second wind. I'm going to give it even more. And now I'm getting a third wind. I'm going to give it even more. It's like determined to succeed today, to say, today I'm going to realize, you know, I'm going to abide in I amness today. Jesus saves today, and I want that salvation today. And work on it like that today's the last day. You can give it everything you got. And then next day, if it doesn't happen for you, you'd go through the ordeal again. It's an ordeal. of rapid, brisk progress and effort. Not just the form of religion of I'm just showing up and you can mark, you know, present, he showed up, or, you know, okay, you attend to succeed today. So it's kind of like a burning desire to say, I just have to succeed today. I just have to break through, you know, have to evaporate that resistance. I have to find a way today. And I'm not just going to hope for it. I'm going to actually listen to the Holy Spirit. What do I need to do today? What do I need to do today? What, you know, how can we maximize the day? So it's a preoccupation. It's a career. It's not just a hobby. It's a career. It's a preoccupation of what is it that needs to my attention. Where does my attention need to be right now? And so when you can get this feeling and you're doing it, then you start to say, you know what, I don't think we need this new world order. That's not necessary, because we're doing what is necessary already without it, you know. And I realize there's no shortcut to it. And so we don't need all this clever technology and all this stuff to get this done. No, this is something that's done simply. Within the Holy Spirit and our spirit as one, and the dance of this continuity fear, blocking ourselves, rationalizing this, looking at it, clarifying it, melting it, evaporating it, getting past it, you know, this kind of stuff. That's all something that has been done throughout the ages in this world and is being done right now. And it's not going to become magically easier just because we have some extraterrestrials running the planet. It doesn't work that way, because they haven't done it themselves. How are they going to help us do what they don't even know how to do? If they would have done it, they wouldn't be so dualistic delusion they have of thinking about this universe is our home, these planets, these bodies are our home, and all this nonsense of believing in these forces that don't exist. They wouldn't even believe them at all. So obviously they haven't done it. If they haven't done it, they must be very lazy in that way. So they're actually promoting spiritual laziness here on this planet, is what they're really doing. And of course, those who are not lazy, they don't need that promotion. They don't need that promotion. They're not interested in that. You know, I want a saint on every corner. So wherever you go, the saints are there. And it's like, wow, you can't get away from them. They're admonishing you. They're admonishing you. Hey, you know, I want people on every corner admonishing us, saying, have you, don't forget your spiritual work today. Make sure you do it today. Otherwise, you know, it's not going to go well for you. And it may be tough love, but it works. Being admonished is tremendous. See, if something that really gets your attention, you realize, wow, I'm really coming up short here. I need to dig deeper. So there needs to be a thirst for that, rather than a thirst for this hedonistic nonsense that the New World Order is promoting. Elevating laziness to an art. Elevating basically saying, you can learn to love hell. Don't worry. You will learn to love hell. We'll help you out. We're experts. No. They always find someone else that's the problem, and they have to conquer them too. They say, well, it's just not working because there's someone else somewhere that isn't with the program properly. If we just institute this structure on them, then we'll be happy. But we have to make everybody love hell here, or else it won't work. And of course, within us all is this intense dislike of this hellish situation that can never be gotten rid of except by realizing it never existed and never will, and giving up the attempt to make it real, seem real. Giving up the attempt to make it seem real. That's the strain and stress that we have. And so when the world asks us, can you help? Nobody can help me. Well, what they want is they want to make it seem more real here. making it seem more plausible that forces that don't exist exist, making that seem more plausible, that's hurting. That's making it worse. It's making it worse. So we can't help them with that. Absolutely not. So very freeing to say, no, I cannot help you. Absolutely cannot help you with that. Thank God, you know, thank God for that. So they don't want any abundance to come in any way, or happiness anyway, except through that which they see as the appearancing, which they think lends credence to the belief in time, space, form, process, and form. They don't want anything to be present that is not accounted for according to their imaginary laws. But of course, the saints, their presence is not accountable in that way. They cannot account for it. And therefore, they turn away from it. They say, "Wow, that doesn't help me. I don't want that. That makes me lazy." They think that makes them lazy because they're working hard at being lazy, actually. But really, they're afraid of, "Uh-oh, I may have to stop being so lazy. Uh-oh, I don't know about that." You see? Okay. So I have to keep working today, intensely here. The opportunity and just. See what can be done. So I'll wrap this one up. This is a generalized pep talk along with some very tremendous clarifications. Fundamental clarifications, actually, in this video. Fundamental clarifications. We cannot help with that goal at all. Nothing we can help with that goal. The way to overcome the New World Order is that we simply don't need it. Okay? The spiritual work ethic is what protects us from temptation. And the opposition to the New World Order, a lot of it, the negative opposition, saying, "I hate it," that is largely part of the New World Order. It's fake opposition to capture our attention, thinking that this is what works, and ignoring what really works, okay? We think, oh, if we support this opposition, that will work, and in doing so, we ignore what actually works. That's how clever they are. And that's not that clever. Once we see it, we say, that's like childish antics, you know, once we see through it. And on and on and on, here we go. Here we go, here we go. So the next page that was today so far is like, wow, what a terrific page that was. So now you get to look at the next page. And it's bound to be even more tremendous, great good news. So here comes the gospel. Here comes the gospel. That's it.